Welcome to the Big Scope Interviews. Today on the show, I've got somebody now who's trying to change the entire paradigm of how coding has been looked in India so far. On the show today, I've got Sachin Gupta. He's the CEO of HackerEarth. Sachin, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me here.
Great. Help me understand. I mean, there's so much that I've heard about you guys. You know, you help so many people. Say a person doesn't want to even finish his education. Like, they come on your platform, is good at coding. You help them catapult their careers to a different level, to an enterprise probably. Who are you guys? What are you doing in India so far? Help me explain that.
Sure. Let's learn how to program. Mm-hmm. And with that, mm-hmm. what HackerEarth started. Mm-hmm. And coincidentally, we said, okay, we'll learn how to program by teaching other people how to program. Kind of, what should I say, oxymoronic. But mm-hmm. essentially, whatever we were learning, we're just putting that onto a website mm-hmm. and opening it up to the audience. Mm-hmm. And that's a very, you know, that's the base of how we started. Of course, over the period of, like, now it's been five and a half years,
yes.
the company has grown a lot, it has changed a lot.
Yes.
We've gone from just helping people do basic programming to today helping them build mobile apps, solutions that they can not only do for their own learning, but enterprises can adopt these solutions and put it into their business. So it could be, you know, you could start working with an enterprise or your solution gets adopted and gets famous and all of those things. So basic programming to changing the world in some sense.
So see, I mean, when we talk to a lot of users, and I mean in the smaller towns, I mean, the reason I say smaller towns, the tier 3, the tier 4 towns, because that is where the next billion is. That is where
Absolutely.
People are getting smartphones for the first time. They're the people who are getting they're turning from feature to smartphones for the first time. They're seeing the power of data revolution. Overnight, they are learning things on internet that never seen before. Now, why I say coding is important, because it's not about what job you'll get because you have a particular programming skill. It's about the analytical thinking qualities that you get as a kid when you're 12, 13, when you learn certain things. So how do you plan to reach out? I mean, I understand you have a play in the urban areas over the years when I've reported on you folks. How do you plan to reach out these folks in the smaller towns? I mean, people who are just going to go into graduation or in high school. How do you take this message out saying, boss, no, it's just not for a job, this is a coding thing. Is there something else? It's about analytical thinking abilities. How do you plan to do that, at least in this year?
Okay. So a very relevant point that, you know, you mentioned is it's not just about which programming skill
exactly.
you learn, it's about the analytical thought process. Mm-hmm. And that's why even though the technical skills are changing at a very rapid pace, mm-hmm. the smart guys are still relevant.
Yeah, exactly.
Correct. So how do we plan to take it to tier 3 and tier 4? It's a hard problem to solve because, you know, at the end of the day, to be able to learn programming, you do need mm-hmm. some basic mm-hmm. infrastructure.
Fair.
But
Fair.
With the internet, and you know, the cheap availability of a laptop and a mobile phone, I think it is possible. So I think for us, the easiest way to kind of do that would be through existing channels like universities.
Okay.
So we partner with a lot of universities and we are basically location agnostic. You could be a tier 3, tier 4 or a new university. So what we do there is we first try and empower the students. So we go to the students and say, this is what we have. You can come and learn here.
Interesting.
You can practice, you can compete. And we evangelize, we have a small team doing that. And if we are able to do that, great, because I believe peer learning is the best. You know?
Yes,
if
yes.
I like it, I will tell 10 other people.
Correct, word of mouth.
In addition to that, mm-hmm. we also go and talk to the placement cells.
Okay.
So we say that the kind of students you are probably churning out today are mm-hmm. not going to cut the bill.
Mm-hmm.
You know, recently Steve Wozniak mentioned that. I don't completely agree with the statement
okay.
that he has. But
I was about to ask you that, but what do you make of that?
There is some element of truth.
Okay.
Because, digressing a bit, I'll come back to the tier 3 and tier 4, but what has happened over the last two decades mm-hmm. is that, you know, India has become a services powerhouse.
Oh, it has.
Right? Mm-hmm. And I would say that's declining right now. Mm-hmm. And I would bet my money on that.
Mm-hmm. And it should, ideally, because it helps other industries grow.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So what the services industry created was a copy, and I'm not mm-hmm. trying to denigrate anyone. I'm just saying that it was a cut, copy, paste model. Mm-hmm. You build one application for a bank, you just modify it a bit and apply it elsewhere. Mm-hmm. So that was the model that services industry had. So they did not need people who probably should have creative problem solving skills, because it was at some level a mundane job.
Correct.
So they were, it's not like people are not capable. The industry was asking for this kind of talent.
It's like a back office coder, that's
yes.
it. I mean, you know, you just have to churn out the same thing over and over, same
exactly.
lines of code.
Exactly.
Correct.
All the work has already been done, but what's happening now is the product boom that's taking place.
Exactly.
India is becoming a product nation. And you don't build products the way you do services.
Absolutely.
So that has to change.
Fair.
Now, obviously, the academia is lagging behind the industry, which is true.
Fair. I agree.
But with, again, the advent of internet, what's happening is computer science learning, at least, I don't know about civil mechanical, but computer science learning is democratized. I have an internet connection, I have a laptop or a phone, I can be a programmer. So it now rests on the individual whether they want to be good or
good
not. And I think for us, university is a good medium to go out because, you know, going out at en masse at such a scale can be difficult. So first we're going through universities where we either work with the student groups or we work with the college administration. And we say, here's a structured program. Forget you do what you're doing in your courses, but do this as well because this is practical learning. And you know what's the difference? The difference is, on the other hand, we've got these enterprises across sectors who are facing technological problems. So we know what's real and what's today. So we're not telling you something that's going to, that's already happened in the last one decade. So it's real-time learning that gets transmitted. And I think that's where we have made some inroads. What's interesting is you mentioned schools. You know, today we see schools doing hackathons. And these are school kids. I don't even remember what I was doing in my 10th or 12th class, but today people know how to build a mobile app.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And it's amazing. Though that's still centered in urban areas, but I'm pretty sure as you know the infrastructure improves, that's go down, that will trickle down. And I think somewhere everyone here has a responsibility to kind of take this message.
So great, but let me stop you at that. You know, you mentioned about the entire school conundrum. Now here's what I've seen, and this is from my own understanding and what I've seen and heard from. I'm not quoting any newspaper or media house on this. Now, schools, especially government schools, the point you mentioned, because this is a very interesting element which has been happening for the last 3 or 4 years. I'm sure you've noticed this. Now, schools in India, especially government schools, for example, take the schools in Bangalore. I visited mostly all the government schools in Bangalore. All of them have computers. All of them have an internet connection, but you know what? They do not have a teacher to teach them.
Yes.
Some of the schools that I went and talked to, some of the principals, they were like, we get a lot of funds. We get a lot of funds which help us build this entire computer education, entire computer class, AC, the new age, CPUs and all of that. But who teaches them? He's like, we don't need more funds to buy these laptops or computers, but we need more teachers. So how do you bridge the gap there?
Okay. Pretty hard problem to solve. I think there are two parts to it. Obviously, we can do some things. So I'll talk about that first, and then I can probably talk about what has to change at a societal level. So from our perspective, you know, what we've done this, at least in universities, what we've done is we have made an individual student a teacher. So the bright guys have the responsibility to go and teach their groups, their circles.
Brilliant.
And they become our evangelists. They evangelize us. Now, what we need is another push to say to these guys, you know, you are in your third year or fourth year of college. Why don't you go out there and teach people?
Absolutely.
And that's where the social element comes in. I think teaching as a profession in India has always been an underdog. People become teacher out of, you know, not out of the passion, but because they don't have any other job. That has to change.
Absolutely. So, absolutely. There's a big payment. Because, I mean, you can, it's like, you have taken an effort of going out there collaborating with the universities, but what about the final leg? Who will go and teach them? I mean, I understand now it's up to people since they have an internet connection. Just go there, I can start coding. It's done. I mean, like you have platforms like Scratch, like the MIT's Scratch for so many years. So having said that, I mean, at the same point of time, has it been difficult for you to grow in India in terms of funding? How do you look at the investment part of it? I mean, I remember you took funding at one point of level and then said, no boss, we don't need funding anymore. Not that we don't want, but you had your own way of looking at churning out money. I mean, how do you do that? I remember hackathons obviously is the most obvious part of it. So how did you build the entire thing?
Correct. So yeah, again, a very valid question. How do we look at fundraise and what's the general take on this? So I would say, Indian VC ecosystem is relatively young. So what today VCs are reacting to are trends. So if as a startup you happen to fall in a certain trend, there is no dearth of capital because you'll get like a lot of money. But if you are out of that trend, or you could be something old or you could be new, I'm just saying if you're out of the trend, people don't understand because they don't have a model. They don't have a hypothesis around it. Now, if you compare this with US, India has probably got what, 30, 40 VCs?
Yes.
US has 480 VCs or something of that sort.
Correct.
Imagine. So there would be somebody who will be looking at some other kind of problem for a given space. So they have enough capital and enough variety of capital that there you would see, you know, companies which sounded stupid, like an Airbnb, was rejected 7 times.
Oh, yes,
right?
Absolutely.
But somebody took a bet on them. That's not happening in India. I think somewhere we also face that initially because, you know, our model was hard to explain. Some people did not get it. But then we said, okay, it's okay, you know, people don't understand.
But I think your model is phenomenal.
Yeah, see, at the end of the day, a business has to survive, right? Mm-hmm. My job is to create mm-hmm. value mm-hmm. and get money out of that so that the business can sustain. So we got down our hands dirty and we said, let's focus on monetization. At the same time, create value. I think that's where hackathons became mm-hmm. a big boost for us. Mm-hmm. It was coincidental. We never planned to do hackathons mm-hmm. when we started in 2012.
Okay.
And but we responded to our customers. Mm-hmm. We were nimble. And 2015 is mm-hmm. when we started doing it. Mm-hmm. And since then, you know, it's been a story. We've done more than 1,000 hackathons across 200 wow. corporates and grown significantly. So I think when you tell yourself that I need to exist mm-hmm. as an organization for a decade, mm-hmm. then you find out ways to survive. Entrepreneurship
Absolutely.
Is about survival.
Absolutely, fair point. And at the same point of time, I mean, how do you then look at women coders? I mean, there's one part, I mean, so many people are coming and there's a lot of initiatives we talk about, you know, Make in India, then yeah. women empowerment. And I mean, recently I was talking to, I wouldn't name the person, but a co-chair of an industry bodies, in IT industry mm-hmm. body in India. And she was like, issues exist for us, mm-hmm. but it's how you scale up. But mm-hmm. the same thing, are you targeting, is there a particular strategy from your side in terms of this is how we're looking at women coders also, girl coders also?
Absolutely. So the problem, yes, so we do focus on that. And in fact, you'll not believe, our first major hackathon was women only hackathon.
Wow.
So
okay.
we launched the product in Jan of 2014 or 15, and okay. March we did the women hackathon. That was the first flagship hackathon.
Wow.
And because I feel if we don't have enough women in tech industry, mm-hmm. we are heading for a disaster. And I'll tell you why. Mm-hmm. This planet has got two kind of people, mm-hmm. broadly two kind of people, right? And if you exclude one set of, let's say even other 5 to 10 different kind of people, if you just focus on one kind of person and exclude everyone else from the decision making, from the innovation, from the production, imagine what kind of solutions we'll end up creating. If only mm-hmm. men are building solutions, mm-hmm. it'll be at the end of the day solutions for men.
I wish more entrepreneurs talk like on this.
We need more females, we need transgenders, Absolutely. We need people who have been marginalized from the society mm-hmm. because they have a perspective.
Exactly.
They have a problem, they look at things differently.
Exactly.
So tech has to solve this problem, mm-hmm. otherwise we're heading for a disaster.
Absolutely.
And our effort, mm-hmm. you know, is on two sides. Mm-hmm. I think because women have been marginalized mm-hmm. a lot over a period of time, they do need, you know, some people debate, hey, why mm-hmm. women only things? Mm-hmm. Because, you know, they've been marginalized, right? Mm-hmm. So you need to create safe havens for them so that they don't feel afraid, they're not afraid of stepping into it. Mm-hmm. And on the other side, we also try and mobilize industries. See, it cannot happen with just one entity. Mm-hmm. Industry has to step in, support it. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad that there are a lot of organizations yeah. that understand it. So I think year on year, even today, just recently, and I'm happy to share these numbers. When we first did our women-only hackathon, we had, what, I think 500-600 women mm-hmm. at the end of the day. This time, we had 4,000.
Brilliant. This is last year's numbers.
Yeah, in this March, okay, we'll be concluding. So registrations have already closed.
Okay.
So in just 3 years, we've gone from 300-400 to 4,000, 10x growth. So I think market is also responding to it. But
exactly.
collectively, we all need to put in a lot.
Exactly.
Of
it's like, you know, I mean, I remember going after a story a year back about how I was looking for women black hats. Everybody mm-hmm. talks about black hat means mm-hmm. men. That's it. There's a full stop over
Correct.
There. I'm like, no, man, there are brilliant women coders. Mm-hmm. I went on Twitter, I went on Reddit, started mm-hmm. searching them. And I was to my surprise, there was I found around 800 top women black hats from across the world. Some of these folks were sitting out of Argentina and doing mm-hmm. and they're like, okay, nobody asked me for an interview ever. Mm-hmm. I'm like, why not? I mean, mm-hmm. these are as good as a man. So mm-hmm. that difference, because it's all about how you solve a problem through a line of code.
Exactly.
Irrespective of a man, woman or a trans.
It doesn't matter.
Exactly. After all. So you mentioned these hackathons you're mentioning. I'll come to how much does it contribute to your revenue? That's one part of it. The second thing I want to ask over here is, you know, traditionally, if you think of hackathons, I mean, anybody, even from a government official or anybody, oh, hackathons means, okay, only IT companies,
yeah.
these major IT companies will take your resources. But the last 2 years, interestingly, I've seen a lot of non-IT companies coming forth to organizations like yours. It's like, you know what, I also want to solve a problem through an hackathon.
Hmm.
I also want to see the benefit of having a hackathon.
Right.
How has that grown for you? Collaborating with non-IT companies for hackathons.
So that has happened very rapidly, and you're again bang on this point, has happened very rapidly in the last 1 year. So when we started doing this, we were obviously going to our usual customer base, the ITs of the world. Today we work with retail, and I'm not talking Amazon, hardcore retail, kirana shops. I mean, obviously, you know, at a larger scale, but those kind of retail. We are talking to pharma, we are working with healthcare, we are working with banking, of course, is one of the early disruptors by tech. We are talking to aerospace engineering, hardcore product engineering, even mining and
interesting.
Oil.
So, interesting.
And you know why this happened? The rate at which businesses are being disrupted has shrunk from decades to a few years.
Yeah.
And add on top of it digital, and there is chaos everywhere. So these businesses understand that if they don't change themselves, they'll become irrelevant in a couple of years because digital will kill them. But let's say even if digital doesn't kill them, the consumer nature is changing today. You know, we want more things. Look at the number of mobile models that we have. When mobile started, models would change in what, 3 years?
Exactly.
Today it's like 3 months.
Yeah, absolutely.
So even if you're not a digital platform, you still have to roll out a lot of new things at a very fast pace. Now, what hackathons do are, they're essentially about three things. Creative problems, two things. Creative problem solving.
Yeah, exactly.
That's it. It doesn't matter whether you're a programmer. You could be a designer. I could get in a designer and a music composer and solve a problem in the space of hours. That's what a hackathon can do. Because creative people come together. You put a time constraint and you tell them, think innovatively and come with a proof of concept that can be demonstrated. So the best thing about hackathons is that, see, anybody can come up with an idea.
Correct.
It closes the loop. It's not just an idea, but a working model or a prototype. So you demonstrate. So you let your job do the talking. It's not about your idea or my idea. It's about what this thing is doing. If it is worthy, it should be adopted. So that's why we've seen across industries, they're both looking for tech digital solutions, but they're even using non-digital solutions through hackathons.
Well, that's a big change, man. I mean, you come from a, I mean, I know some of these 100-year-old IT giants work with you. You know who that giant is. It's, you're saying from that, even kirana stores are working with you for hackathons.
Yeah.
Explain what would a kirana store come to your platform for?
So when I said kirana store, I'm typically talking about obviously the large...
The retailer, even the large retailers.
So for example, a Future Group is going to come to us and say, the consume... So what a kirana store today does not... It is, you know, it has a very captive audience.
Yes,
because
agreed.
It's only the people in those sector that come, you know, that area that come
correct.
To them. So they have a great opportunity to profile the users because I know their back patterns in and out, right? But they're not doing it. Every time it's a new order.
Correct.
And you know, the most successful kirana guys are the ones who map their customer.
Yes.
They already know, you want
correct.
This, I'll send it to
correct.
You, right?
Correct.
They're the ones that become big and they
correct.
Become their stores become big.
Interesting, correct.
So why can't technology do that? Can there be small little things that I can put, I track you every time, just a facial recognition software that sees, it gets tagged to your, you don't even need a point of sale machine. You show your bill, your kacha bill or pakka bill, doesn't matter, and the facial recognition software, and I know who you are.
Fascinating.
And then I can now control supply and demand, because I know this neighborhood is probably consuming a lot more wheat bread as opposed to maida bread. And I, as a godown supplier, can match that supply and demand.
Fascinating.
So I think
you're actually right. I mean, I remember talking to a startup who I think is in Bangalore. I mean, without naming the gentleman and his company, they try to do the same thing. They're like, see, these are people who've never been touched by tech. They've never even seen anything related to digital, anything related to tech. And what these guys are doing is they're building these, they're building a physical device which will have a touchscreen and all. It'll be kept at every kirana show. So this, so say, a wheat flour manufacturer which we consume on a day-to-day basis. They are putting their ads on that tablet.
Right. Yeah.
And everything is now RFID tag for him in the room. And for these guys are like, a lot of my things are solved. I don't have to keep two or four more people
correct.
Who will tell me so much amount of this, so much amount of this is needed. So yeah, absolutely bang on. Oh, hackathons for retail consumers. That's fascinating for me.
Even for us, you know, when customers first came to us, I was skeptical because we thought we are mostly a tech community. So this has an impact on the community side as well. What we are saying is you don't just need to be a programmer. You may
exactly.
have domain expertise. And if you can think creatively, let us pair you with a programmer and you guys come together with a solution. I think that's where we can even go to tier 2 and 3 or 4 cities and say, it's okay if you don't have a solution, you do have problems, right?
Correct. Correct.
Tell us your problems.
Correct.
That's there might be someone problem. Else sitting in, you know,
absolutely.
Some remote part of the world.
Absolutely.
You'll pair the two and you can solve
that's what the whole basis of creative problem solving in hackathon stand for. Great. So, a couple of things. How much does this contribute to your revenue standalone?
So,
if you can give me a, not a ballpark figure, just help me understand how much
yeah,
the standalone.
So, from in 2-3 years, from zero it's to almost 40-50% today.
Okay. Oh, that's...
That's
a serious lot. Great. So also, before going to other questions, I want to understand, I remember you write a lot sometimes,
yeah.
I mean, about the top, I remember reading one of your blogs last year about why this was the top programming language. Help our viewers understand today, what are the top programming languages specifically in India and why? Okay. I mean, obviously, you could have gone on GitHub and all these other platforms,
correct,
realize why people are going to one,
correct,
platform.
So, there are two parts to that answer.
Mm.
If you want to get a job, a stable job,
mm,
so all said and done, there are still large MNCs which operate on traditional stacks and you can get a job.
Mm.
It may not be the most satisfying, but you'll get a job.
Mm.
If that's your motivation, the traditional languages like C, C++, Java, .NET, they rule the roost.
Mm.
So I'm not interested in that because I think that's a, I'm not saying these languages are, they're great. In my opinion, I'm language agnostic.
Mm.
Like we discussed right here, if your fundamentals are strong, it doesn't matter
exactly
what language you are. But today we have a lot more powerful frameworks which can help you do a lot more things which were not possible earlier through these frameworks, through these earlier technologies. So, you know, if you go into the front end, there's React.js and then there is the whole jQuery JavaScript stack. People need to know that. You don't. If you don't know how to make a UI element, you'll not be able to build an application.
Yes.
On the back end, I would say Python, R,
okay,
Ruby, just
okay
on the languages. If you want to pick up a new language, start with these and pair it with C. So see what happens is, C will give you fundamentals. Python will give you the power. So if your fundamentals are strong and you can use a language very powerfully, then you're sorted. So I would still recommend a traditional language to solve fundamental concepts, but use these ones to quickly prototype. Then we obviously go into technology domains. People need to know mobile. It's not
absolutely
even mobile only, mobile first. It's not mobile only.
Correct.
A lot of
things
are becoming mobile only.
Correct.
Apart from these technologies, I would say there are two trends which are very powerful. One of them is data science. We are collecting trillions and trillions and I don't know zettabytes of data,
absolutely,
right? And
so if, structured data out there.
If you don't know how to work with data, I can say that in the next 10 years you will be you know, just another person.
Okay.
I was just speaking to a guy who works in a mining and oil exploration company. You know, he says whatever job I do, Sachin, in 3 years there'll be a data science model that can do it.
Yeah, exactly, absolutely. I mean, especially mining is oil exploration, it all depends on that, right?
And it will be far more accurate. Because human intelligence is still, the memory is still capped. Our intelligence is a lot, but memory is capped.
Correct.
I think data science is something that people have to get familiar with, which is a combination of programming as well as, say, mathematics, statistics, and basic numbers, being comfortable with numbers. And the other trend would be AI, which is, again, very broad. I would largely break it down into three things. Vision, speech, and language processing.
Okay.
So if you could do something on vision, like you understand basic vision processing, they're like powerful libraries. There is an OpenCV library in C, which helps you do everything, right?
Wow.
I can look at your face, determine who you are, which country you belong to, all of those things. Speech is also, again, Google has a lot of these APIs, and NLP, again, a lot of language processing APIs are there. So if one is very ambitious, they should start doing small little things in this. The best way to learn a skill is to do it. That's
absolutely
our philosophy. Go and build something and you'll be able to learn it.
Absolutely, great. Couple of last things. I mean, I remember you also have hosted hackathons for government.
Governments,
and considering there are so many of these various digital platforms that the government is harping on day after day. So what's your play with the government of India right now? What all have you done for them?
So we're working with a bunch of state governments. We work with the Rajasthan government, Karnataka government, AP government, and talking to a bunch of others. And what's happening is governments are becoming enablers. Their job is to, they will not obviously own the technology. Their job is to bring together various stakeholders. And so for example, Rajasthan government is focusing a lot on data education.
Yes.
AP is focusing on
fintech.
Karnataka government is very worried about traffic and particularly from Bangalore perspective.
Correct.
So they pick up problems and they sponsor these problems and we become a channel through which they can solve these problems. So their job is to get the, what should I say, the demand side, you know, the players in the industry. We try and get the supply side, people who can solve these problems. And you know, it works beautifully in government scenarios because government is trying to do civic welfare, right? And who knows civic problems better than the end user?
Correct.
So we did this Rajasthan hackathon. We had people from I think Udaipur, Jaipur, Marwar, you know, remote areas coming and being part of it because they were facing these problems and these kids had solutions. So they had a working prototype that they could come and present. I think like 700, 800 software developers came into that in Jaipur. So yeah, that's our play with government, I think. And we do it, you know, wherever needed, if needed, we do it pro bono because we want to be part of this and we want to enable this.
Interesting, interesting. So, you know, that being said, I mean, what more needs to be done if you look at, is this the max UPI can go or what more needs to be done with UPI as a platform?
So I think you...
Because you folks have, in a way, got associated with them initially.
Yeah, so NPCI, we worked with NPCI during the initial launch of UPI. So I would say UPI infrastructure conceptually is good.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
Right? And mm-hmm. I don't think from a feature capability perspective, mm-hmm. anything else is needed in the 1 or 2 years mm-hmm. in the future.
Mm-hmm.
What we really need to do is make it safe and mm-hmm. secure. Mm-hmm. And what I mean by that, I'm not worried about security. See,
mm-hmm.
technology comes with its own challenges. I won't say negative sides.
Mm-hmm.
If the entire digital economy of America can run on credit cards,
mm-hmm.
can't we do that with here in US? Well, there's just a, I would say, attitude and skill gap.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the system has to be far more stable and far more secure. That's probably because, you know, the mainstream population hasn't gone into, mainstream coding population hasn't gone and started working with governments.
Mm-hmm.
It's the same like NASA.
Mm-hmm.
The brightest researchers go to NASA, they don't come and work with ISRO,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
We need to change that.
Mm-hmm.
So UPI should have the best coders from the country. And
mm-hmm.
I think once that happens, the system
will
become
sense.
Far more stable
yeah.
and secure and scalable.
So we will wind up. You also launched today something which has to do with startups and enterprises, bringing both the worlds
yeah.
together. What is it that you,
yeah.
what's the role you're playing over
yeah.
here? I want to understand in detail.
So see, over the last 3 years, when
mm-hmm.
we started doing a lot of these hackathons, we realized businesses were essentially
mm-hmm.
solving
mm-hmm.
their critical problems,
mm-hmm.
you know, problems that were threatening them, whether they would exist
mm-hmm.
in 2 years or 3 years or now.
Mm-hmm.
And we were now helping them solve it through the open community. Some of the businesses came to us and said, I want to work with these, but I also want to work with startups because I may have very narrowed down problems that probably a startup can address. And this was a business problem that we faced. We looked at our community and we realized, you know, in the last 2 years, there are 4 or 5 startups that have started out of the hackathons that we have done. So we said, if these guys are there, I'm sure there'll be other startups as well. And we being, you know, having gone through that journey ourselves over the last 5 years, it is extremely hard to navigate through an enterprise. You know, it's like an elephant of a mammoth walking and you're like a small ant. How do you even get to, they see you. See, they want to work with you.
Correct.
But for them, discovery and engagement
Correct.
Is a huge problem. For you to know what this elephant does, you know, I may be looking at their trunk and I don't even know a tail exists.
Correct.
So how will I identify where should I be, you know,
Correct.
Fitting in?
Correct.
So I think that's where we come in. We distill down the problem statements that a business has, put it out on a platform, make it broadcast or, you know, attract startups to come and participate in that, and they can either put in their existing
wow.
solutions
okay.
or they can adapt the solution and either co-create, so both enterprise and startups can work together, get incubated, co-innovate, go to market together. That's up to them. So we don't do the transaction as such.
Okay.
We do matchmaking and discovery.
Okay, lovely. Thank you. Certainly, it's been an enlightening conversation with you. Thank you so much for, and I hope you wish you all the best with your, you know, what you want to do in smaller towns and take the whole concept of coding to as many people in India as well. But thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot for having me here.
Thank
and
you.
All the best for your initiative as well.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.